think in this day and age, though, commitment is almost old-fashioned. No, I'm serious. I think it's it's out of fashion in times when, you know, marriage and you know, couples were together for long periods of time, that day has passed. And
ooh,
now,
that day is
looking at men and even women, they have so much choice that they don't need to commit. They don't feel like commitment is something that they need to do.
Now, let me ask you, brother. Do you think it's like that because so many people are working and trying to make money instead of putting God there to raise a family and have a commitment to God?
I think definitely, you know, people, you know, especially brothers, we want to do well, we want to exceed. We see our man knife wonder on the TV, and we see, you know, someone on the TV, we want to do like that. And in order to get there, you know, we don't have time to be at home. We didn't have time to be with our, you know, our girlfriend or we're trying to go get that money. So, I think that's definitely a factor. But, again, like I say, I don't think that commitment is fashionable as it once was, you know?
Vickie, yeah. You got a question for the brothers?
Mm-hmm. Well, somebody asked me the other day. They said they wished the Bible... First of all, they said they wished the Bible had been written different. And they want to know, and it wasn't me, it might be me, but I'm going to check.
It was her.
Why wasn't marriage written like an open-end car lease? An open-end car lease. You stay with each other till the lease is over. When that joint is over, you turn that thing in. Wait a minute. And you pay for the damages. And you get you somebody, y'all go there. That's what I want to know. What you think about that? I know it's impossible, according to the Bible. That thing is real in life.
So I guess basically you ask me, can you have a marriage where you can trade in and move on when you feel like you're not in that?
But you got to pay for the damages.
Fellas, what you think about that? I think most brothers live like that right now.
That's what that is right there. That's what it is.
I think a lot of people live like that already, male and female. If you think about it, I think there's also a creative way to do that within the same relationship. So I think if you want to take that concept and you want to upgrade, you upgrade your cell phone, they upgrade anything else, if people can take that same concept and apply it to the relationship they're already in, you know, and take the relationship to a place where they've evolved to a place where now they're renewed. You know, that's why people renew their vows sometimes. You know, they get to a place where, okay, we understand that in certain ways we change. We may have outgrown each other, we may have grown or evolved at different rates. And instead of completely just cashing in on you know, dumping you aside and going out shopping again, because there's a lot of people wish they could go back to where they were because the shopping ain't going too well.
They call the window shop.
Yeah, you know what I mean? But I think there's a way to do that within the same relationship you're in. And I think that's the challenge. Keep that relationship everything fresh, keeping the priorities that you said at the very beginning, keeping those priorities present. Reminding yourselves every day, giving each other positive affirmations, not being threatened, you know, by one another, not playing these power dynamics that people play with each other, you know, really having some serious mutual growth so that at some point you can say, hey, we're now in a different place, we're at a different phase of our development. Instead of turning you aside and, you know, moving across the street, we're just going to remodel this house right here.
I got two different kind of cars.
Yes.
I have a regular car, then I got a Phantom.
My dog.
Now, on my regular car, I'm leasing that joint.
Uh-huh.
Cause I don't pay no attention.
Uh-huh.
You know, it get banged up, whatever. But my heart is in what I'm buying. So therefore, when you come to the table in the beginning without a lease mentality, and you buy in for life, then the outcome will be different. Y'all need to be screaming. Y'all need to be screaming.
Yeah.
Mr. Kennedy, tell us.
Yeah, I was about to ask her, is she the banged up car or is she the friend? All right, so everybody said their friend came up.
Come on, man.
We need the world to be a fan, but we want a fan of that too, right?
That's right.
That's right, yo.
That's right.
Okay.
I think. We should go back to the first question that was posed on
commitment.
In commitment. And my brother assumes that by the question that men don't commit. When the truth of the matter is this, that commitment is not outdated and men do commit.
Yeah.
It's the boys that don't commit.
Yeah.
There's a recession going on in the land.
Idris Alba, you want the head on.
As a recession of economics. But the real recession is a recession of men. There are reported about seven women to every man that walks in the United States of America.
Okay.
So when women find out who they are, from a biblical perspective, men are seen and women are soiled. The Bible says, except a seed fall to the ground and die, it can't bring forth fruit. So if a woman is soil and a man is a seed, then she has a greater responsibility. When a seed goes into the dirt, the dirt first kills the seed. When you have a man, ladies, that came from someone else's tree and he comes to your soil, the first thing you got to do is kill the past activity. When the seed falls into the soil, it's covered up, the soil then kills the seed, knocks out of its outer core, its inner core, and it sprouts a root and a sprout. So the job of a woman is to grow a man down and grow him up at the same time. If a man is in your garden, ladies, and you don't root him real well, then his tree is going to lean into another garden to get what he needs.
Oh. Now, Bishop, let me tell you, you just, I got to say,
I've been wanting a piece of you for a long time. You've been on my nerves for a long time.
You know what, Bishop? You know what? That's it. I normally don't admit this. I don't let people know I live in North Carolina. You know, I live in North Carolina. People think I live in D.C., Atlanta, Chicago, but I live in North Carolina. I'll be at your church Sunday morning.
All right.
So tell me what you just said up here today.
Right.
I'm going to be at your church Sunday morning.
515 Dow Street here in the city of Durham, North Carolina.
Now, fellas, let me ask you this question. And ladies, help me out with this in my world. We all love President Obama, right? Fellas, what do you think about interracial dating? Why is it that women get so upset when they see other nationalities dating each other?
I don't.
Anybody?
I think it's a situation that everybody gets upset. It's not only women getting mad at us. I've heard a lot of women say, you know, there's no good brothers like you said. There's no good brothers, so I'm gonna date outside my race as well. You know what I'm saying? Like that's the what's going on right now. They date outside the race, whether it be Asian, whether it be, and they move into big cities. So if they move to big cities, therefore it's a multicultural situation. So it's not only just white man, it's Asian man, it's Latino man. It's international market right now. You know, that's what it is.
So it's an international market. So interracial dating, we shouldn't be getting mad about that, man.
I think it's more not necessarily of interracial dating, we just need to pinpoint it. It's dating white men. That's the problem. That's the problem. That's the
thing. Is it wrong to date a white woman?
You said
they're wrong.